My warm greetings to all the members who are a part of today's discussion. Today, I, C.A. Venil Shah, on behalf of the Bhuj branch of WIRC of ICI, am supposed to express my views on a very interesting, very important, very relevant and very useful topic, which is the important changes in income tax law relevant for assessment year 2021. Now, talking about the changes in income tax law, we all would be knowing that any change in income tax law is brought in by a finance act. So now, when talking about the amendments for assessment year 2021, which finance act are we supposed to discuss of? Now, I will give three options to you all. First is the Finance Act 2019 number 1. Second is Finance Act 2019 number 2. Two finance acts, as 2019 was an election year, so interim budget and then the final budget. And finally, the Finance Act 2020 that we discussed just 3 to 4 months ago. Now, as it is the human mentality that we generally remember the things that we have learnt last, just like a student does, so we are all more conversant with the provisions of Finance Act 2020. But then, as we all would be knowing, that the provisions of Finance Act 2020 generally come into force from 1st April 2020, that is assessment year 21-22, and so they are more important from the planning perspective for the next year rather than they are not important when filing return for this particular assessment year. So now, what are the changes which are important for this particular assessment year? For that, we need to take recourse to two finance acts, Finance Act 2019 number 1 and Finance Act 2019 number 2, that we discussed in the last year's budget. Now, they are the amendments that are more relevant for this particular assessment year. Now, the big task in front of all of us is to file all the ITRs, complete all the tax audits and file returns pertaining to tax audits. So, this is a big job in our hands. So, today, on behalf of Bhuj branch, we have made an initiative that we are planning to make a discussion on various topics. Not just the change in income tax law. We will also be discussing changes in the ITR forms for AY 2021. And we are also discussing some other intricate aspects that are relevant when we are filing return for AY 2021. So in a way, I can say that this is a revision. This is a revision of all the provisions, all the changes, all the things that are applicable when we are filing return for assessment year 2021. I have not made this session very technical, as I feel that discussing various provisions in a short period of time. So what I will be doing is I will be explaining all the provisions to you so that it becomes very useful to you all when we are filing returns for assessment year 2021. So first of all, I will be starting with the very basics and then we will move to the technical part. Fine. So first of all, what is an income tax return? Income tax return is a form that the department intends every assessee. Now, not every assessee. Then which kind of assessee? Assessee who fulfills required conditions. Now, what can be the required conditions? The required conditions can be income exceeding a particular level, entering into certain specified of transaction, being a specified kind of assessee. Now, if any of these conditions are fulfilled, then to file the return stating the particulars of his income, means what is my income and tax payable thereon. As we all know that in India, the system of assessment which is more prevalent is the self-assessment, because every year some 6 to 7 crore returns are filed, and it is not possible or practical as well for the department to call each and every assessee and check his required records. So in this case, the department insists more on the self-assessment mode, and as per a department circular, every year only 2 to 5% of the returns that are filed are selected for scrutiny assessment. In other words, we can also tell this to be that 95 to 98% returns go unnoticed. It means they go in the way as filed by the assessee, and no checks and balances are adopted by the department. So now department cannot just keep 95 to 98% of the returns for heaven's sake. It has to implement proper checks and balances so as to ensure that all the returns that are filed are properly filed, the assessee cannot evade taxes, and department gets all the information that it needs by ITR forms. Fine. This becomes a source of present revenues. Now, with an ITR, the tax payable thereon is also paid. So, this becomes a source of present tax revenue for the department and contingent future revenues. Contingent means something which is not sure. It may happen, it may not happen. So, what do I mean by contingent future revenues? Suppose I am filing my ITR. I have skipped one information of one particular income in that ITR, and somehow it comes to the notice of the department on the basis of ITR filed by some other person. In that case, department can serve a notice to me and I need to pay the tax applicable thereon, so it becomes a source of future revenue for the department as well, but it is contingent, may happen, may not happen. for the department as if there is any mistake in filing the ITR, intentional or unintentional, and it comes to the notice of the department, it becomes very expensive for the assessee. But now, as we all know, that all the 95 to 98% of the returns which are not checked by the AO, they are checked by CPC. So what the CPC or the department is trying to do is, they are trying to implement or they are trying to seek such kind of information in the ITR on the basis of which the CPC or the computer itself can check whether everything is properly filed or not. Like form 16 issued by the employer and details filled in ITR 1 are checked simultaneously, and if there is any issue, notice is issued under 143 1A. In this manner, every year the ITR forms keep on changing, and in all these changes, what is happening is department is trying to seek more and more information from the assessee, and we as professionals are supposed to inculcate all that information in the ITR that we file. Next question: who is required to file an ITR? A very obvious question, and all of us are aware of this particular thing. And yes, as you all would be knowing, it is 139(1). 139(1) talks about mandatory filing of returns. Now, I am not discussing 139(1) in detail, but I have highlighted 139(1) as there are two amendments in 139(1) in the Finance Act 2019. So first of all, we will be having a basic overview of 139(1), and then we will be discussing two amendments. One is pertaining to the 6th proviso to 139(1), and the other is 7th proviso to 139(1). So first of all, we will discuss what is 139(1). According to section 139(1) of the Income Tax Act, an assessee needs to file income tax return on or before the due date of filing ITR. First thing, due date of filing ITR. This year, due to COVID-19 pandemic, the due date also has changed. I have covered it in another slide. When the total annual income exceeds the maximum amount which is not chargeable to tax. Here two terms become important for me. One is the total annual income, and the second is exceeds the maximum amount which is not chargeable to tax. So first, what is total annual income? This is not the total income. Say suppose my gross total income is 3,80,000 rupees and I have deposited 1,50,000 in my PPF account. So my total income is 2,30,000. In this case, though I am not supposed to pay any tax, I am not having any tax liability, still I am under an obligation to file my ITR. Why? Because my total income exceeds the maximum amount not chargeable to tax. Here I am not talking about total income after deductions under chapter 6A, I am talking about the gross total income. So this thing needs to be kept in mind, though all of us will be aware of it. Exceeds the maximum amount which is not chargeable to tax. Now the second question is, what is maximum amount not chargeable to tax? Now, we get to learn from the newspapers that this year the maximum amount not chargeable to tax is 5 lakhs, or some so-called intelligent client of ours who feel that they are very updated inform us that this year till 5 lakh rupees no tax is payable. Fine, it's true to an extent, but it is not the maximum amount not chargeable to tax. Maximum amount not chargeable to tax remains the same as it was earlier. That is, in case of individuals, it is 250. For individuals greater than 60 years of age, that is senior citizens, it is 3 lakh rupees. For super senior citizens, that is aged greater than 80 years, it is 5 lakh rupees. So if as an individual my age is less than 60 years and if my income exceeds 2,50,000 rupees, though I may not be required to pay any tax, still I am under an obligation to file an ITR. Though my income or my tax may be adjusted against a rebate, though my income may be adjusted against deduction under chapter 6A, still I am required to file an ITR. Fine. Second, besides, there are certain categories of assessees like companies, LLPs, firms, they need to file return of income mandatorily without considering their income. Yes, this is very obvious, as LLPs, firms, companies, they need to file their ITR. It is compulsory for them to file an ITR irrespective of the income that they have earned. Even if their income is zero, they have made a loss, even if they don't want to carry forward their loss, still they are under an obligation to file an ITR. So this is the provision as it stood earlier. Now there are two amendments in 139(1). One pertains to the 6th proviso and second pertains to the 7th proviso. So first of all, we'll be talking about the 6th proviso. As per 6th proviso to 139(1), currently a person claiming rollover benefits of exemption from capital gain tax on investment in specified assets like house, bonds, etc. is not required to furnish a return of income if after claim of such rollover benefits his total income is not more than the maximum amount not chargeable to tax. Let me explain this to you with a very simple example. Suppose my income from other sources is 2 lakh rupees. That is the only income I am having. And suppose I have made a long term capital gain on sale of immovable property of 1 crore rupees. So my total income would be 2 lakh plus 1 crore. That is 1 crore 2 lakh rupees. But suppose I have purchased another immovable property. Suppose I have purchased another house and have claimed exemption under section 54 of 1 crore rupees. So my long term capital gain on sale of immovable property is adjusted against exemption that I am supposed to take under section 54. So it is adjusted. So now the only income that remains with me is 2 lakh rupees. Now this 2 lakh rupees become my total income, and as this is less than the maximum amount not chargeable to tax that we discussed earlier, I am not under any obligation to file my ITR. So in this case, I have claimed an exemption of 1 crore rupees. How will the department know that I have claimed an exemption of 1 crore rupees? In this case, this was the provision as it stood earlier, that I was not required to file an ITR if I claimed the exemption, and then after it, my income is below the maximum amount not chargeable to tax. Now, what is the amendment? In order to make furnishing of returns compulsory for such persons, it is proposed to amend the 6th proviso to section 139 of the Act to provide that a person who is claiming such rollover benefits on investments in a house or bond or other such asset under 54, 54B, 54D, 54EC, 54F, 54G, 54GA and 54GB of the Act shall necessarily be required to furnish a return if before claim of such rollover benefits his total income is more than the maximum amount not chargeable to tax. So in this case, I have to consider my income before claiming these exemptions. So as I gave the earlier example, my income before that exemption is 1 crore 2 lakh rupees, and in that case I will be required to furnish an ITR though I am not required to pay any tax. Now why this is necessary? When I am claiming a deduction of 1 crore rupees under section 54, it is necessary for the department to check whether I have complied with all the conditions of section 54. Now, if the department does not know that I have claimed an exemption under 54, how will the department come to check the conditions? So now, when I am filing an ITR, claiming a big exemption under 54, though I am not required to pay any tax, but in future, the department can call me and check whether I have complied with all the conditions listed in the Income Tax Act for claiming exemption under 54. If it is so, then it's fine. But if I have not complied with any of the conditions, then it becomes very risky for me, as now I am even supposed to file ITR in these cases. Leave everything aside, if I have no other income, my long-term capital gain is 2 crore rupees, which is adjusted under section 54, still I have to file an ITR. So now we have to be very cautious when we are claiming exemptions under section 54, as when this amount is particularly mentioned in the ITR, department may call us to check whether we have complied with all the conditions carefully or not. So this is the amendment under 6th proviso. Now talking about the 7th proviso. 7th proviso has been added to 139 bracket 1, which also mandated the following persons to file their return of income. Now 7th proviso says that though you are not required to file income tax return under 139 bracket 1, still if you fulfill either of these three conditions, still you are required to file an ITR irrespective of the income you have earned. Fine. The first condition: individuals who have deposited more than rupees 1 crore in one or more current accounts in financial year 1920. Talks only about individuals, and the deposit in current account, one or more current account, exceeds 1 crore rupees. Now if my income is below 2,50,000, from where am I going to deposit 1 crore rupees? Now you may say there are some sources from where I may have earned 1 crore rupees deposited in my current account and still I may not have any income chargeable to tax. The department also wants to know, from where have you deposited this 1 crore and still not made 250. So in these cases, an ITR filing becomes necessary. Second, individuals who have spent more than rupees 2 lakh on foreign travel on himself or herself or on any other person in financial year 1920. Say suppose you are telling that your income is below the maximum amount not chargeable to tax, and still you or your family is going abroad on foreign travel, and if you are spending more than 2 lakh rupees on it, the department believes that there are very few persons who are spending out of their old capital, and you may have earned a lot of income. So in this case also, the department gives you an invitation to come and file an ITR. Third case: individuals who have paid more than rupees 1 lakh as electricity bill in FY 1920. So if my electricity, see now, These days electricity bill is also becoming a standard of living, as people are having air conditioners at home, heaters at home. So all these are also becoming a standard of living. So if you have spent more than 1 lakh rupees on your electricity bill, the department may think that you may be earning a lot, but you are not showing your income nicely. So in that case as well, you are supposed to file your ITR. So seventh proviso talks about three things: deposit in one or more current account exceeding 1 crore, expense on foreign travel on yourself or any other person exceeding 2 lakh, and electricity bill expense paid during the exceeding 1 lakh rupees. In these cases, irrespective of your income, you are under an obligation to file your ITR. So these are the two amendments to 139 bracket 1 which are very important. Now we'll continue our discussion in the 139 family. First of all, this is how the income tax return form seeks information. Are you filing return of income under 7th proviso to 139 bracket 1 but otherwise not required to furnish return of income? This is a screenshot of how the Genius software seeks information when we are filing ITR. If we select no, this means that we are not required under 139 bracket 1 7th proviso to file. We are otherwise required, that is, our income exceeds the maximum amount not chargeable to tax, so we are filing the return. But if we select yes, then we are supposed to furnish these details as well. Fine. Now continuing our discussion in the 139 family, the very famous hotcakes 139A and 139AA, that is PAN and Aadhaar linking. First of all, the provisions of 139A are proposed to be amended so as to provide that every person who is required to furnish or intimate or quote his PAN under the Act and who has not been allotted a PAN but possesses the Aadhaar number, means if you are not allotted a PAN but you are possessing an Aadhaar number, then may furnish or intimate or quote his Aadhaar number in lieu of PAN. In that case, you can furnish your Aadhaar number, you may not quote your PAN number, and such person shall be allotted a PAN in the prescribed manner. It means on the basis of your Aadhaar, you will be just electronically issued a PAN number. This is how the provision works, as we all would be knowing that now we can generate PAN on the basis of Aadhaar by just giving an OTP. That's it. We are not supposed to file a form and then wait for a long 15 days. It is done immediately. Second, every person who has been allotted a PAN, it means you are already allotted a PAN. In the first section, you are not allotted a PAN. In the second, you are allotted a PAN and has linked his Aadhaar number under 139AA. Means you have a PAN, you have Aadhaar, and both of them are linked with the income tax department. So now, for the department, whether you give your PAN or whether you give your Aadhaar, it is immaterial, because both things mean the same to the department. On the basis of your Aadhaar, the department can track your PAN. On the basis of your PAN, department can track your Aadhaar. May furnish or intimate or quote his Aadhaar number in lieu of PAN. So if you are allotted PAN which is linked to Aadhaar, then in that case, instead of your PAN number, you may furnish your Aadhaar number, because now as both are linked, you cannot keep the audit trails away. Fine. So this is the amendment in 139A. Now talking about the amendment in 139AA. Now 139AA is a provision by which department every year frightens the SEC that if you do not link your Aadhaar card, we will do this. If you don't link your Aadhaar, we will do this. Then every year Supreme Court comes in between and tells the department not to be very harsh. And this year also the same thing has happened. 139AA. In order to protect the validity of transactions carried out previously through PAN, suppose I had entered into a transaction earlier and had quoted my PAN number earlier. Now the department says that if I have not linked my Aadhaar and PAN, then my PAN would become invalid. So what about my previous transactions? So a relief has been given. Finance Act 2019 has amended the provisions to section 139AA bracket 2 to provide that if a person fails to intimate the Aadhaar number, the PAN allotted to such person shall be made inoperative. It means I cannot now operate that PAN number, rather than without declaring it invalid. So earlier their intention was to declare the PAN to be invalid. Now it won't be declared invalid, it will be just declared as inoperative. So this is a relief given to the assessee by the department. So these are the two amendments in 139A and 139AA. Now moving ahead, due date. There is a change in due date due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So the dates as they stand today, I am furnishing to you all, I feel that these may change ahead. The due date for filing income tax returns for assessment year 2021 has been extended to 30th November in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic. Now we are in July, so now just 4 months are left for filing the income tax return, and in India still there are many parts where lockdowns are still going on. So we may expect that if the situation persists, then this date even may get extended, but let's stick to this date, and we may think that if we file the returns till this date, it is well and good for us. The due date for furnishing tax audit report has been extended to 31st October 2020. This year, the date, this is not a mistake. Some of you might be thinking that I have made the wrong placements. No, this is how it is. The date of tax audit is earlier and the date of ITR is late. This is how the provision is. The due date for investments in Chapter 6A deductions has been extended to 31st July 2020. Now, as you all would be knowing that the first lockdown came from 23rd of March. Now, it is general mentality of people that they make investments in ATC or Chapter 6A, like ATD and all those things, in the last week of March. Because till 31st March, they were required to make their investments. But now, as in the last week, there was a complete lockdown all over India. So, people could not make investments. They intended to make investments, but they could not make investments. So, in the light of this, what the government has done is, they have extended the due date for investments from 1st April to 31st July. So, now, if I make investments till 31st July, then also I can claim the deduction of it, not in assessment year 21-22, but in assessment year 2021. This is an option to me. If I have made my investments of assessment year 2021 earlier, and now if I am making any investment in this particular year, I may relate it to AY 21-22. That is purely my choice. So, investments made between 1-4-20 to 31-7-2020 would also be eligible for deduction under ATC or any other deduction of Chapter 6A. And consequent changes in all the ITRs have also been made to give effect to the above provision. So, this is an amendment, and department has also brought consequent changes in the ITR forms which help in filing these details. So, how has the change in ITR been brought in? I have just disclosed it. Whether you have made any investment or deposit or payment between 1st April 2020 to 31st July 2020 for the purpose of claiming any deduction under Chapter 6A. If I select no here, then it's absolutely fine. If I select yes here, then all these columns would be allowed to be filled and I can enter the details of investment that I have made between 1st April to 31st July and for which I am claiming an exemption under AY 2021. So, today, on today's CP, we are around some 10 to 15 days. We still have some 10 to 15 days left for the purpose of ending 31st July. So, still, if any client of ours wants to make investment for AY 2021, still we have an opportunity for the last 10 days. Fine. Now, the income tax return is to be furnished in a particular form, which is termed as an ITR form. ITR forms available for e-filing range from ITR 1 to ITR 7. The first three ITRs, that is ITR 1, 2, 3, are applicable to individuals and HUFs. ITR 4 is applicable to individual, HUF and partnership firm who are opting for presumptive taxation under 44AD, 44ADA or 44A. Now, under these three sections, if I am offering my income under presumptive taxation, then I can file an ITR 4. ITR 5 is applicable to firms, LLPs, AOPs and BOIs. ITR 6 is applicable to companies and ITR 7 is applicable to trusts. This is a very basic chart, where I have not discussed any detail, any minute detail of the ITRs, but now I have prepared a separate chart where I have discussed the minutest details of all the ITR forms. Now, I advise that if some of you are not clear with all the ITR form selection, then you may take a printout of this particular chart and paste it in your office. It may become very useful to you. First of all, talking about ITR 1, to whom is the ITR 1 applicable? ITR 1, that is the Sahaj form, is applicable to individuals or HUFs who are resident in India. Resident and ordinarily resident. So, to whom it is not applicable? It is not applicable to non-residents. It is not applicable to not ordinarily residents. Only resident, ordinary individuals and HUFs can file an ITR 1, that is the Sahaj form. Now, what kind of incomes can be offered for taxation under ITR 1, or which category of income holding assessees can file ITR 1? Salary income is permitted under ITR 1, as it is the salary return, so salary is obviously permitted. House property income is permitted, but only pertaining to one house property. I can offer income only of one house property under ITR 1. If I have rented more than one properties and getting rent of it, then I cannot file an ITR 1. Income from business is not allowed. Capital gains is not allowed. Income from other sources is allowed. Exempt income is allowed, but agricultural income is allowed only up to 5,000 rupees. If I have agriculture income exceeding 5,000 rupees, then I cannot file an ITR 1. foreign incomes are not allowed and carried forward losses are not allowed as well. So this is how ITR 1 stands. ITR 1 is the very basic form of income tax return, where there are very limited particulars that the income tax department expects from the assessee. No need to file any balance sheet, no need to file any financial particulars. So we generally love ITR 1, but this is a very limited form where only limited kind of assessees generally having salary and IFOS can only offer this income, can opt for this particular form. Coming to ITR 2. ITR 2 is applicable to individuals and HUFs. Now here there is no condition of resident. So residents, non-residents and not ordinarily residents, everyone can file an ITR 2. There is only one thing that is not allowed in ITR 2, which is income from business. If I am having income from business, I cannot file ITR 2. Otherwise, every other individual or HUF can file ITR 2. Salary is allowed, house property allowed, any number of house properties are allowed. If you have offered rented 10 properties, then also it is permitted. PGBP is not allowed. Capital gains is allowed. IFOS is allowed. Exempt income is allowed. Unlimited foreign income allowed. Carried forward loss. Everything is allowed except PGBP. ITR 4. Now I am discussing ITR 4. ITR 4 is applicable to individuals, HUFs and firms. Now which individual, HUF or firm? Only those individual, HUF or firm who are offering income under 44AD. 44AD, that is for professionals, and 44A, that is for transport operators. Now only these, if you are offering your income under these three sections, then and only then you are supposed to file an ITR4. Otherwise you are not allowed to file an ITR4. Now what are the incomes that are allowed under ITR4? Salary is allowed, fine. House property allowed, but only one house property, similar to ITR1. Business income is allowed, but only presumptive business income. No other business income is allowed, fine. Capital gains not allowed. IFOS allowed. Exempt income allowed, but agriculture income is permitted only up to 5,000 rupees. Foreign incomes not allowed, and carried forward losses not allowed as well. Now if you note out very carefully, there is only one difference between ITR1 and ITR4, that is, in ITR1 you cannot declare any income under business, but in ITR4 you can declare income under presumptive scheme. Everything else remains the same for ITR1 and ITR4. ITR4 for business persons is also very basic form, where you are just supposed to fill in your financial particulars and you are not supposed to upload your entire balance sheet. So this is again a relaxation. Coming to ITR3. Jiska koi nahi uska ITR3. Individuals, HUFs and partners in a firm. Every kind of income is allowed under ITR3. Salary, HP, PGBP, capital gain, IFOS, exempt income, foreign income, carried forward loss. Everything is allowed in ITR3. So I would say that if you are not permitted to file ITR1, ITR2 and ITR4, then in that case the lender of the last resort will be ITR3 and you will have to file ITR3. ITR3, as per the department's way, is the most extensive and most detailed form, where everything is allowed, fine. So these are the four forms which are generally applicable to individuals and HUF. Now coming to ITR5, firm, LLP, AOP and BOI, ITR6 for companies and ITR7 for trusts. Now there is a uniformity in all these forms. Now in all these forms you can declare income under every head. You can declare income under HP for firm, company, trust, for PGBP, under capital gains, under IFOS, under exempt income, under foreign income, under carry forward loss. Every head of income is permitted under ITR5, ITR6 and ITR7. Only one head is not permitted, salary. Because it is very obvious that these are not natural persons, these are artificial persons, so they cannot do job anywhere. So it is not possible for these assessees to earn salary income. So salary is not permitted. Otherwise, everything is permitted under ITR 5, 6 and 7. So this is how all the forms ITR 1 to 7 of the department work. Fine. Now, applicability of audit for this particular assessment year, it is very important, and there is an amendment in Finance Act 2019 for the audit. Fine. Every person carrying on business shall, if his total sales, turnover or gross receipts, as the case may be in business, exceed or exceeds 1 crore rupees in any previous year. The limit is 1 crore rupees only. The limit is neither 2 crores nor 5 crores. Now, then what about 2 crore and 5 crore? I'll be explaining about it in detail. But as of now, the provision says that limit is 1 crore rupees only. Discussing it further, from AY 2021, government inserted a proviso in the said clause so as to provide that in case of a person whose aggregate of all amounts received, including amount received for sales, turnover or gross receipts during the previous year in cash does not exceed 5% of the said amount. Means, now the government, see, the basic limit applicable for tax audit is 1 crore rupees. Now, if you want an extended limit, then you will have to fulfill two conditions. The first condition is, if your receipts from any source, sales, revenue, gross receipts, anywhere, it should not exceed 5% of your total receipts. Condition number one. Second condition. And here the word used is and. So you have to fulfill both these conditions. You cannot fulfill either one condition. You have to fulfill both the conditions simultaneously. And the aggregate of all payments made, including amount incurred for expenditure in cash during the previous year, does not exceed 5% of the said payment. It means cash receipts do not exceed 5% of the total receipts and cash payments do not exceed 5% of the total payments. Then the word 1 crore, this clause shall have effect as if for the word 1 crore rupees, the word 5 crore rupees had been substituted applicable from AY 2021. So it is very clear that the limit for tax audit has not increased to 5 crore rupees. The limit for tax audit stands as it was earlier at 1 crore rupees. Only if my cash receipts are less than 5% of total receipts and my cash payments are less than 5% of my total payment, then and only then the limit has been enhanced for me from 1 crore rupees to 5 crore rupees. So again, there is one more thing which talks about 2 crores. It is not pertaining to this finance act, but then again I have prepared an additional slide which talks everything about audit. So all the limits of audit are shown in this particular chart. Category and limit, tax audit applicability chart, again a very important chart. Basic limit under 44AB is as it was earlier, that is 1 crore rupees. Having turnover exceeding the basic limit under 44AB, basic limit is 1 crore, but if your turnover exceeds 1 crore rupees, but offering income under 44AD, that is 6% or 8%. See, if your turnover exceeds 1 crore rupees, but still, if you are ready to pay tax, if you are ready to declare income of 6% on bank receipts and 8% on cash receipts on your turnover, then the limit for you only has been extended to 2 crore rupees. Means, if you offer tax under presumptive scheme, you can have an audit limit of 2 crore rupees. Otherwise, the basic limit still remains as it is at 1 crore rupees. Now, this is not very much relevant because, see, if a particular client of ours is having a turnover of 1.5 crores and say suppose half of his turnover is in check and half of his turnover in cash, then on an average he needs to declare 7% income. So it becomes 1.5 crores, 7%, so 10,50,000. So just for the So just for the sake of saving his audit fees, nobody is going to pay this much hefty tax. So for me, the limit remains 1 crore only. Fine, there may be some instances where people may declare income under 44AD, but this becomes very less in number. These kind of people are very less in number. So first, basic limit 1 crore. If you offer income under presumptive taxation, limit for you is 2 crore rupees. Now the third thing. Having turnover exceeding the basic limit under 44AB means your turnover exceeds 1 crore rupees, but fulfilling the conditions of proviso inserted by Finance Act 2020 means if you fulfill the conditions, which two conditions? Cash receipts do not exceed 5% of total receipts and cash payments do not exceed 5% of total expense, then in that case the audit limit, tax audit limit is 5 crore rupees for you. So 1 crore, 2 crore and 5 crore in this chart are portrayed very clearly so as to make it very clear in your mind as to what is the tax audit applicability. And last one, limit under 44ADA for professionals stands as it stood earlier, that is 50 lakh rupees, and they need to offer income at 50%. If it is less, then also they are supposed to come under audit under 44ADA. So this is the tax audit applicability chart. Now I feel that we have had a lot of basic discussion. Now we are coming to the most important part, that is amendments in Finance Act 2019. Now we will be discussing one by one all the amendments of Finance Act 2019. We have had all the discussion of basic topics, fine. First change, standard deduction under section 16(1A). Now government, India has a lot of salaried employees and all the business persons have the opportunity of not offering income under taxation as there are no proper checks and balances for income that you make under business. So every year the government has to give some kind of relief to the salary taxpayers also. So government this year has increased the limit of standard deduction from 40,000 to 50,000. Let's see. The standard deduction under section 16(1)(a) has been increased from ₹40,000 to ₹50,000. The concept of standard deduction was introduced for the first time by Finance Act 2018. So this concept is not very old. This was introduced by Finance Act 2018 and which stands enhanced by Finance Act 2019. So first this was brought in by 2018. Again, limit has been increased in Finance Act 2019. This is in lieu of medical and conveyance allowance, which was earlier allowed to the employees as exempt. Medical allowance of ₹15,000 was allowed and conveyance allowance of ₹19,200 was allowed as exempt. So ₹34,200 was allowed earlier as well. What the government did in Finance Act was, rather than giving these deductions, what the government insisted is to give ₹40,000 as standard deduction to all employees. And again in 2019, they have increased this to ₹50,000. With the introduction of standard deduction, the erstwhile exemptions of medical and conveyance allowance stand withdrawn. Now these exemptions are not allowable, only one standard deduction under 16(1)(a) is allowed. Fine. This is a chart. In AY, say suppose your gross salary in all the three assessment years 18-19, 19-20 and 20-21 is 10 lakh rupees. In 2018-19, medical allowance of 15,000 and conveyance allowance of 19,200 was allowed to you. So your total income would have been 965,800. In AY 19-20, the standard deduction allowed was 40,000. So your total income would be 960. In AY 2021, gross salary 10 lakh and standard deduction is 50,000. So your total income would be 950,000. So these are all the three ways in which the taxation of salary is done. So this is just a basic illustration. Now moving forward to the second amendment, rebate under 87A. This was to make the voters happy. In the interim budget, the government enhanced rebate under section 87A to ₹12,500 if your total income is less than 5 lakh rupees. Now this is a very interesting amendment, and I will be taking your 2 to 3 minutes to discuss about this amendment, because in my view this is very important. It will be available to a resident individual only. Non-resident is not permitted to take deduction. HUFs are also not allowed to take rebate. Only individuals resident whose total income after reduction under chapter 6A. This income is after reduction. It is not like that it is applicable on gross total income. It is applicable on net total income. Does not exceed rupees 5 lakh. The maximum amount of rebate can be up to rupees 12,500. So this is the limit of rebate, which was earlier 2,500, which has been enhanced to 12,500. The slab of 2,50,000 to 5 lakh rupees. Still, the maximum amount not chargeable to tax for ordinary individuals is 2,50,000. The limit has not been enhanced to 5 lakh. So now the slab of 250 to 5 lakh is taxable at 5%. Is chargeable at 5%, and hence no tax is payable if income is up to rupees 5 lakh. So from 250 to 5 lakh, the income is 2,50,000, and multiply it by 5%. So your tax payable would be 12,500, which would be adjusted against your rebate. So no tax is payable now if your income is up to 5 lakh rupees. This is a misconception in the minds of many, though it may not be in our minds, but it is a misconception in the minds of various clients and various tax practitioners as well. Now I would clarify this misconception. This will not be the case where any incomes are chargeable to tax at special rates like 111A, 112 means short term capital gain or long term capital gain, etc. also form a part of assessee's income. As you all would be knowing that taxation of capital gains is made at special rate like 10%, 15%, 20%. So in those cases, you will not be allowed to offer income up to 5 lakh rupees as exempt. Why? Because suppose your income under other sources is 2,50,000. Fine. And you have made a long-term capital gain on sale of immovable property of 62,500, which is taxed at 20%. So 62,500 into 20% would be 12,500. So your rebate of 12,500 would be wiped out by just 62,500. So in that case, if your income exceeds 3,12,500, you will be required to pay tax. So this is not the case where limit has been extended to 5 lakh rupees. This is the case where rebate of 12,500 is applicable. Yes, if there is no special taxable income, then the limit is 5 lakh rupees. But if there is any special category of income, still we need to remember that the rebate is of 12,500 and 5 lakh rupees is not the exemption limit. This is a very clear provision. Now the concept of paying tax of rupees 1,000 or 2,000 will no longer be relevant. See, if my income is up to 5 lakh rupees in normal cases, no special income is there, then I am not supposed to pay any tax. But if my income is 5 lakh 1 rupees, my income is total income is 5 lakh 1 rupees, then I will not be just required to pay tax on 1 rupee. I will be required to pay total tax as my rebate of 12,500 would be withdrawn. Why? Because my income exceeds 5 lakh rupees. Then in that case, my tax liability will always be greater than 12,500 rupees. Now the concept of paying tax of 1,000 or 2,000 will never be relevant, no longer. Fine. Next, in case of special incomes, in case of no special incomes, minimum tax will be 12,500 rupees. You will not be allowed to pay any tax less than 12,500. If some client of ours insists to pay 1,000 or 2,000 rupees as tax, then now that provision is no longer relevant. We have to tell him that either you pay more than 12,500 or you file a nil return. Now the second amendment is 80 CCD 2. The central government has increased contribution to NPS from 10% to 14% of salary. Now, this 4% has been enhanced by the central government as a gift to all the CG employees. Now, as this contribution has been extended, so a consequent or similar amendment has also been brought in under 80 CCD2, where by Finance Act 2019, so as to provide a deduction of 14% to central government employees. Now, as the contribution has been enhanced, so is the limit also enhanced. But one thing which is to be noted very carefully, as of now, this amendment is not applicable to state government employees. This is applicable only to the central government employees whose contribution has been extended under NPS from 10 to 14%. And now under 80 CCD2, they will be allowed a deduction of 14%. Fine. Next amendment. Two properties to be treated as self-occupied. Now, all over the country, also in Bhuj and Kutch as well, the concept of second home or weekend home is more relevant. So the department has also understood this. Now, as we knew earlier that only one property by the assessee was allowed to be treated as self-occupied, and any other property in excess of it was, though not given on rent, was treated as deemed to be let out, and notional rent on it was chargeable to tax. But now government has increased this limit of one house to two houses. Now you can treat any of your two properties as self-occupied, and only the balance will be taxable either on the basis of rent or on the basis of notional rent. So this is a good relief. Earlier, the assessee had an option to choose any one of his house property as self-occupied, and all his other house properties were treated as deemed to be let out, and the notional rent on such deemed to be let out properties was chargeable to tax, though we never offered it to tax. Now this limit of one house property has been enhanced to two house properties. Now some of you might be thinking that this is no big relief. Fine, it's acceptable because we never offered notional rent for taxation. But then please note this thing very carefully. The assessee can now claim two properties as self-occupied and only the rest will be treated as deemed to be let out. Fine. There were cases where the AO had the balance sheet of the assessee and AO treated only one property as self-occupied and charged the notional rent on other properties which were portrayed in his balance sheet at notional rent, and they were offered for taxation. There were cases, you can just have a brief note of it. There are cases where notional rent on deemed to be let out properties is charged to tax by the assessing officers, though we generally never offer these incomes for taxation. Second amendment, deduction under section 54. This is again a very big relief and an important change which we need to properly take note of. If the assessee has made long-term capital gains on sale of residential property, he was entitled to deduction under section 54 of the amount of capital gains if the entire amount of capital gain was invested in purchase or construction of a residential house. Suppose I had sold a long-term residential property and had made a long-term capital gain on it. Now I can claim exemption of that long-term. I could claim an exemption of that long-term capital gain if I invest the proceeds of those long-term capital gains in the purchase or construction of a residential house. In the purchase or construction of a residential house means only one residential house. Now a relief has been given under section 54 with Finance Act 2019. What is that relief? Now this exemption will be available for two houses. Means I can invest my long term capital gain in purchase or construction of two houses, not just one house, subject to the following conditions. So now what are those conditions? The amount of capital gain must be up to 2 crore rupees. If your capital gain exceeds 2 crore rupees, you cannot claim this benefit. If your capital gain is up to 2 crores, you can claim surely this benefit. This exemption can be availed only once during the lifetime of the assessee. Means you can claim this benefit only once during your lifetime, and you cannot keep on claiming this benefit every passing year. This is like a Brahmastra which can be used only once in your lifetime. Fine. Then the next amendment. Change in rate of depreciation in respect of motor cars. Friends, as we all know that the situation of auto sector had been worse. It was very poor, like sales was very down, inventories were piling up. So the government tried to give an impetus to buying by giving some relief in the rates of depreciation applicable on motor cars. Owing to a great slump in the auto sector, the government has enhanced the depreciation rate on motor cars to give an impetus to buying. The motor cars, please note this very carefully, it is very important. The motor cars purchased between 23rd of August 2019 to 31st March 2020 will be allowed higher depreciation. As we all know that the depreciation rate applicable to motor cars is 15%, and if it is used in the business of hiring, then 30% rate of depreciation was applicable earlier. But now, if you have purchased a motor car between 23rd August and 31st March, you will be eligible to claim a higher deduction of depreciation at the following rates. Motor vehicles, general rate was applicable at 15%. Now the new rate is 30%. Motor vehicles for the business of running them on hire, it was the earlier rate was 30%, which has been enhanced to 45%. So 15% increase in depreciation is given if you have purchased a car between 23rd August to 31st March 2020. Please note these dates very carefully. And yes, if the there are some conditions also which are attached to this particular deduction, let's have a brief discussion of all those conditions. Otherwise, we cannot just claim this additional benefit. It should be put to use on or before 31st March 2020. Purchase is not enough. The condition of put to use also is relevant. This is just a one-time relief. It means that the depreciation, higher depreciation rate of 30% and 45% will be applicable only for 1 year. It is not the case that where this block will be a special block wherein every year 30 or 45% depreciation will be allowed. This is just a one-time relief. Normal rates will apply from the next year. Means if I have purchased a car not for the business of running on hire, then for the first year I will be eligible for 30% depreciation, and from the next year normal depreciation of 15% will be applicable to me. If the asset is put to use for less than 180 days, half the depreciation will be allowed. These are not flat rates. These are rates applicable per annum. So if I have put the asset to use for less than 180 days, I will be allowed half the deduction in current year and the remaining half will be allowed in the next year. Suppose I have purchased a car for less than 180 days for the business of running on hire, then half of 45, that is 22.5, will be allowed to me in the current year. 22.5 balance would be allowed in the first half of the next year, and for the remaining half I will be allowed depreciation not at the rate of 45 but at the rate of 30's half, that is 15%. This is how I interpret this section. Balance can be taken in the next year. The next amendment is prescription of electronic mode of payments. Now, as the country is moving towards digital India, the government has brought in various amendments which allow digital payments to be made. Now, in these sections, along with account pay, check, account pay, bank draft, use of ECS, electronic mode of payments are also permitted under these sections. So what are these sections? 13A, donation to political parties. 35AD, deduction for scientific research. 40A, expenses exceeding 10,000. Section 43 talks about actual cost. 43CA talks about like 50C is applicable where stamp duty value and all these things are applicable. In case of business, 43CA is applicable where your stamp duty value, you are offering stamp duty value where your stamp duty value is lesser than the rate at which you are selling the property. And if you have taken an advance earlier by account pay check, account pay draft, or now electronic mode of payment also is permitted. 44AD, 80JJAA, that is deduction in respect of additional employees. 269SS and 269ST amended. So now in all these sections, along with account pay check, account pay bank draft, ECS, electronic mode of payments are also permitted. This is not a big amendment, this is just a small thing that I am discussing with all of you. There are various provisions in the act which prohibit cash transactions and allow or encourage payment or receipt only through account pay check, account pay bank draft, or electronic clearing system through a bank account. Fine, along with all this, this particular thing was also added. Relief from notional rent to the builders lobby. Now friends, this concept of notional rent was introduced with a reason. the builders were trying to make more and more profit. They were not ready to sell their properties at a lower price, and the government insisted that people should buy houses, but people were not able to buy houses due to higher rates charged by the builders, which they are while they indulged in excessive profiteering. So to avoid this excessive profiteering and to make the hands of builders shake, what the government did is they introduced the provision of notional rent earlier, so that the builders had no other option but to sell the property at reasonable rates so that people could purchase those properties. But now the inverse case has come, where the builders are unable to sell their properties even at reasonable rates or at their cost. So in this case, the government has extended the limit of charging notional rent from 1 year to 2 years. Owing to slump in the realty sector, owing to low demand, the government has enhanced the moratorium for computation of notional rent from 1 year earlier to 2 years. This period of 2 years will be counted from the end of financial year in which completion certificate is obtained. I have given an example as well. Example, if completion certificate in respect of building is obtained on 10th May 2019, then 2 years from the end of financial year. So first of all, the end of financial year will be 31-3-20, and to add 2 years to it, so it becomes 31-3-22. So in respect of completion obtained on 10-5-19, no notional rent will be charged up to 31-3-22. So this is a big relief to the builders lobby. Relief to NBFCs. Owing to the IL&FS crisis, as we all know, the health of all the NBFCs across Pan India has been very poor. To help the NBFC sector, the government has introduced payment of interest to NBFCs under 43B. As we all know that 43B talks about some mandatory payments which, if not made till the due date of filing return, we cannot claim deduction of it, like any taxes, GST, VAT, like interest to banks. Now interest to NBFCs also is added to 43B. It means that if I have taken a loan from NBFC and if I have not paid interest on that loan till the due date of filing return, then I will not be allowed a deduction of that particular expenditure. This means that now, like banks, this provision was applicable for banks earlier as well. If interest remains unpaid on any loan borrowed from NBFC, its deduction will be allowed subject to actual payment condition. The deduction will be allowed when the interest is actually paid and not on the basis of book entry. If the payment is not made till the due date of filing return, such deduction would not be allowed in that year. Further, like NBA, further like banks, one more relief is given to NBFCs. Now, NBFCs are also permitted to create provision for bad and doubtful debts under Section 43D. At time, it happened that majority of the lendings of NBFCs turned bad. So now the government has understood it, and the government has also permitted NBFCs to make provision for bad and doubtful debts as it has allowed to the banks under 43D. So two reliefs to the NBFC. First, payment of interest to NBFCs has been added under the list of 43B, that is payments allowed subject to actual payment condition, and NBFCs are also permitted to make provisions under 43D. Next, 80EEA, it is in respect of interest on housing loan. This deduction is available only to individuals for interest paid on home loan. The government is doing a lot for making the people purchase house, and this is one more relief for the people. Deduction is up to 1,50,000 rupees. This is in addition to interest allowed under Section 24. This means that first of all, you have to claim deduction. You have to claim 2 lakh rupees exemption under Section 24, that is interest on house property, and in addition to it, 1.5 lakhs more. So total 3.5 lakh rupees are allowed as deduction of interest on home loan, subject to fulfillment of required conditions. The assessee should not own any other house property on the date of sanction of a loan. So when the loan is sanctioned, you should not have any other property. This should be the first house property of yours. The loan should be taken from a financial institution or a housing finance company. Now, under Section 24, as you all would be knowing, that I can claim exemption under Section 24 even if I have borrowed a loan from my friend and am paying interest to him. But this is not the case with 80EEA. Under 80EEA, I will be allowed deduction only when I have borrowed it from a financial institution or a housing finance company. If I have borrowed loan from my relative or friend, then this deduction will not be allowed. Stamp duty value of the house property must be up to 45 lakh rupees. If it exceeds this particular level value, then it is not permitted. Fine. Carpet area limit for metro cities is 60 square meters and for other areas is 90 square meters. Say suppose for Bhuj the limit of carpet area is 90 square meters. So construction of around 1000 square feet is permitted under 80EA. So if we are claiming deduction under 80EA, we need to keep a check of all these conditions. Only if we fulfill these conditions, we can claim deduction under 80EA. Deduction under section 24 stands undisturbed at 2 lakh rupees. Fine. 80EB. Now electric vehicles, EVs are getting an impetus, and the government has also tried to give more impetus to the EVs by introducing a deduction under 80EB. With a view to improve environment and to reduce vehicular pollution, it is proposed to insert a new section 80EB in the act so as to provide for a deduction in respect of interest on loan taken for purchase of an EV from any financial institution up to 1,50,000 rupees subject to the following conditions. The deduction is not in respect of purchase of EV. The deduction is in respect of interest paid on loan borrowed for purchasing an EV. Fine. If the loan has been sanctioned by a financial institution including a NBFC during the period beginning on 1st April 2019 to 31st March 2023, financial institution or an NBFC, loan from friend or relative is not permitted. The assessee does not own any other EV on the date of sanction of loan. So on the date of sanction of loan, this should be the only EV available with you. You should not have any other EV on the date of sanction of loan. So this is how 80EB works. Now TDS related amendments, very important and very necessary as well. There are various amendments pertaining to TDS. First of all, I'll be discussing how many sections of TDS are amended, then we'll be having a section by section discussion. Amendment in 194A, amendment in 194I, amendment in 194IA, amendment in 194DA, amendment in 194M, and amendment in 194N. There are total 6 sections pertaining to TDS where there are amendments, and now we will be discussing one by one all the sections of TDS amendments. 194A talks about TDS on interest. There is an amendment in this section. The limit of 10,000 has been increased to 40,000. Banks, cooperative banks and post office are not required to deduct any tax at source at the time of payment or credit of interest to the account of the payee if the aggregate amount of interest payable during the financial year does not exceed 40,000 rupees. Earlier the limit was of 10,000 rupees. Earlier banks were required to deduct TDS if the interest exceeded 10,000. Now this limit has been increased to 40,000. So if the interest income is up to 40,000 rupees, no tax would be deducted by the bank. So this is a kind of a relief where we are not supposed to bother about this TDS kind of stuff. Now analysis of this provision. The limit for senior citizens already stood at 50,000 rupees. Now you all would be aware of the provision of 80TTB, which allows deduction of 50,000 rupees to senior citizens on interest on savings account, interest on FDs and all these things clubbed together. TTA is applicable to other individuals and TTB is applicable to senior citizens. So earlier along with TTB, the limit for senior citizens already was enhanced to 50,000 rupees. Fine. The interest rates on bank FDRs are now as low as 7-8%. This is also very high now. Some banks have started giving interest of 6%. So now TDS under 194A won't be applicable if the deposits are lower than 5-6 lakh rupees. So if a client of ours is having FDs less than 5-6 lakh rupees in a bank, then no TDS under 194A would be deducted. Fine. So this is the amendment in 194A where limit of 10,000 has been enhanced to 40,000 rupees. Next. 194I TDS on rent. TDS on rent was supposed to be deducted where the payment exceeded 1,80,000 rupees. Now again this limit has been increased from 1,80,000 to 2,40,000. The threshold limit of deduction of TDS on rent payment to residents for use of land and building including factory building or any machinery or plant or equipment or furniture and fixtures has been increased from 1,80,000 to 2,40,000. So limit under 194I has been enhanced from 180 per year to 240 per year. Again a relief. Next, 194DA talks about TDS on insurance receipts. Earlier the provision was LIC maturity receipts are exempt when some conditions are fulfilled, like when my premium is up to 10%, 10% or 15% or some conditions are given, then the entire proceeds that I receive are exempt under section 10 bracket 10D. But if I fail to fulfill those conditions, then the proceeds I receive on maturity are not exempt under 10 bracket 10D. So in that case, I am supposed to pay tax. So to keep a proper check on it, the government had introduced 194D earlier, where the TDS at the rate of 1% was deductible on the entire proceeds that I receive on maturity. But now an amendment has been brought to this section where two things are changed. Two things. Note them very carefully. The rate of TDS has been increased from 1% to 5%. First change. But henceforth, tax will be deducted on the amount of income comprised in non-exempt proceeds of a life insurance policy, unlike pre-amendment era where the tax was deducted on the gross proceeds amount. Rate has been increased from 1% to 5%, that is the first amendment. Earlier, the TDS was deducted on the gross amount. Suppose I received maturity proceeds of 5 lakh rupees, then straight away 5 lakhs 1%, 5000 was deducted at TDS. But now this will not be the case. Now only TDS at the rate of 5% would be applicable only on the income element. Say suppose out of 5 lakh, the income as per the calculation of insurance company is just 1 lakh rupees. So they will be required to deduct 5%, but only on the income element and not on the total element. So now it becomes very clear that if this TDS under 194DA is deducted, then there is no other option for us but to offer it for taxation. We cannot do anything else. This is for one more reason. Like suppose earlier on 5 lakh 1% was deducted, so 5000 rupees was TDS deducted and we offered lower income under our income tax return. But now this option is no longer available to us, because directly the income is shown in the 26AS. So we have to offer it for taxation. So this becomes a relief for the department. Earlier the tax was on the total amount at the rate 1%. Now the tax is on the income element at the rate 5%. Now the tax is only on the income element, but at a higher rate of 5%. So this is the amendment in 194DA. Now, the most important and the most favorite of all of us and all of our clients, section 194N, that is the TDS on cash withdrawals. Now, I will be having a detailed discussion of 194N, where I will be discussing about the provisions in Finance Act 2019, changes that are recently brought in by Finance Act 2020, all the takeaways, all the highlights of this particular section and how I interpret this section. Why Finance Act 2019, a new section 194N was inserted, which provides for TDS at 2% on cash withdrawals exceeding 1 crore rupees from bank, cooperative bank or post office. So my cash withdrawals from either of these institutes exceeds 1 crore rupees, then TDS at the rate of 2% would be deducted. This is just to discourage cash transactions, fine. This was applicable from 1st September 2019 earlier. However, for the calculation of threshold, that is, TDS would be deducted only when I exceed 1 crore rupees and only on the additional amount. Suppose my total withdrawals from bank stand at 1 crore 20 lakh rupees, then TDS at 2% won't be applicable on 1 crore 20 lakh, but it would be applicable on only the amount that exceeds 1 crore rupees, that is on 20 lakhs at the rate 2%. So 2% of 20 lakh, only 40,000 would be deducted. Withdrawals made between 1/4/19 to 31/8/19 were also to be considered. So the provision became active from 1/9, but withdrawals from 1/4 to 31/8 also were to be considered. So suppose I had made withdrawal exceeding 1 crore between this period, then though no TDS was deducted, but then from 1/9/19, from the first rupee that I withdraw, I was chargeable to TDS at the rate 2%. Fine. Now 194N, again an amendment is brought in. Amendment is brought in by Finance Act 2020, where two categories are made. So don't confuse yourself, I'll be explaining everything. This section again stands amended by Finance Act 2020, where two categories are made. Be very clear with this provision. Now in Finance Act 2019, the thing was simple, that if your cash withdrawals exceed 1 crore rupees, 2% TDS would be deducted. But by Finance Act 2020, now two categories are made. For one category, the provision stands as it stood earlier, no change is there. Only for the second category, there is a change. Fine. Cash deposits. Now the two categories are, one is normal cases. For normal cases, the provision stands as it stood earlier, there is no change in the provision. Now a special category has been inserted, where assessee has not filed ITR for all three previous years. Means if you have not filed the ITR for all the three previous years, then a special category is inserted where you belong to. Up to 20 lakh rupees, no TDS is deducted in both the cases. Now between 20 lakh to 1 crore rupees, in normal cases no TDS is deducted. Why? Because I told you that in normal cases the provision stands as it stood earlier, that is only an amount exceeding 1 crore is deductible at 2%. So up to 1 crore in normal cases, there is no TDS. But where the assessee has not filed all the three ITRs and he has withdrawn somewhere between 20 lakh to 1 crore, 2% TDS will be deducted. So all the non-filer of returns have to be very careful. If you have not filed all the three ITRs, previous ones, then even if your withdrawals are between 20 lakh to 1 crore, though your withdrawals do not exceed 1 crore rupees, still tax would be deductible at the rate of 2%. What more? Exceeding 2 crore in normal cases, the provision stands as it stood earlier at the rate 2%. But in this special category, TDS would be deductible at not 2% but 5% rate. And pen not furnished in both the categories, it is 20%. It was earlier also the case. So again, how I explain it? Finance Act 2019 says that if your cash withdrawals exceed 1 crore rupees, TDS at the rate 2% would be deducted. This is the provision in Finance Act 2019. Now, Finance Act 2020 again has brought one more amendment where it has made two categories. Filers of return, non-filers of return. For filers of return, the provision stands as it is, as it stood earlier. That is, only on the withdrawals exceeding 1 crore rupees, 2% TDS would be deducted if you have filed your ITRs. But then, if you have not filed all the three ITRs, here they are very clear with the words, all the three ITRs, then a special TDS rate would be applicable to you, where up to 20 lakh no TDS would be deducted, between 20 lakh to 1 crore 2% TDS would be deducted, and on withdrawals exceeding 1 crore rupees 5% TDS would be deducted. So the only amendment belongs to this category, that is non-filers of return. For filers of return, there is no amendment in Finance Act 2020. So be very clear with this particular provision. So this is how Finance Act 2019, Finance Act 2020 work. Now, highlights of this provision 194N. Key takeaways. 1. This section is inserted to bring a paradigm shift in the minds of people to move towards a less cash economy. 2. You will be shocked to know, for the fortnight ended 23rd March 2020, that is the lockdown period, cash withdrawals from bank stood at a record high of 53,000 crore rupees. A fortnight means 2 weeks. So in 14 days, cash withdrawal from bank stood at 53,000 crores. So this very clearly shows that how India is inclined to cash. So this is to bring a paradigm shift in the minds of people to move towards a digital economy. This section also wishes to keep a check on high cash accounts where no return is filed. This is very important. 2% and 5% is done to ensure that if cash withdrawals of 50 lakhs are made from one account and no return is filed, then the department can keep a check on these accounts. So Finance Act 2020 plugs in this loophole. Again, some more takeaways. The limit under 194N is bank-wise and not branch-wise. Suppose I am having two accounts in SBI. One is in SBI Bhuj and the other is in SBI Madhapur. And I have withdrawn 80 lakh from SBI Bhuj and 50 lakh from SBI Madhapur. Then you cannot say that no TDS would be applicable as my withdrawals do not exceed 1 crore. TDS would be applicable as the limit is bank-wise and not branch-wise. As now all the servers are centralized owing to CBS. Now as core banking is implemented, so all the accounts are linked and the TDS applicability would be bank-wise and not branch-wise. Now bank-wise limit is applicable. So if I withdraw 90 lakhs from SBI and 90 lakhs from Bank of Baroda, then no TDS would be applicable. So division is possible, but that is also possible to an extent. If somebody withdraws 100 crores, then division does not become any meaningful to him. It is applicable on cash withdrawals from all types of accounts like current account, savings account, CC account, OD account, all these accounts of all the branches of one bank would be clubbed to calculate the limit of 1 crore rupees. Be very clear with this particular thing. Then the limit is bank wise and not pan wise. This is a relief. It is bank wise and not pan wise. Suppose I am withdrawing 90 lakhs from 5 different banks, then no TDS would be applicable. I am withdrawing total 4.5 CR, but then no TDS because I am not withdrawing an amount exceeding 1 crore from any of the banks. Meaning if an assessee has more than one bank accounts, he can claim enhanced benefit of the threshold. Some more. Exemption has been given to commission agents registered with APMC whose business model is procuring agricultural produce from the farmers and hence they pay cash to the farmers. Now the business model of general APMC dealers is that they purchase castor seeds, guar, etc. from the farmers and they sell it to the companies. So the entire amount they receive is by way of NEFT or RTGS and they withdraw that amount and give it to the farmers. So this is how their business model is. So if TDS of 2% would be deducted from them, then their profit margin is somewhere between 2%. So entire profit or theirs would be invested. So government has considered this particular thing and has issued a notification where these people would be given a exemption. To avail this exemption, they need to give an intimation to the bank and bank needs to ensure adequate compliance of the conditions listed in the notification. They need to give a license of them being registered with the APMC. All these things are supposed to be submitted with the bank and intimation is to be given to the bank and the liability is on the bank to check whether all the conditions listed in the notification are complied with or no. Tax deducted at source. This is very important thing. Tax deducted at source is deemed as the income received by the assessee under section 198. Now 198 says that if my TDS is deducted, then it is my income. So I also have to consider it to be my income and offer it for taxation. And there is one anomaly in this section. When the finance bill of 2019 was introduced, there it was mentioned that TDS on cash withdrawal. Suppose I have deposited 1 crore rupees in bank, then that may be my income. I totally agree to it. Some or the other element of income might be hidden in that 1 crore rupees. But now if I withdraw that 1 crore rupees, then how does it become my income? Fine. Out of 1 crore, 98 lakh rupees is given to me and 2 lakh is deducted at TDS. Then how come can that 2 lakh rupees be treated as my income? The finance bill had made this mistake where it was mentioned that TDS deducted under 194N would be treated as income received by the assessee, but then in the Finance Act this thing was properly addressed and in the Finance Act it was clearly mentioned that however by proviso to 198 it is clarified that tax deducted under 194N will not be deemed as income received by the assessee. So this is very clear and this is very logical. This cannot be treated as my income and the department has nicely adhered to this provision. So this is everything about 194N, a very important, very interesting and a very relevant section. Now coming forward to 194IA. Under 194IA of the Act, TDS at the rate of 1% of the amount of consideration paid or credited is supposed to be deducted on transfer of certain immobile property other than agricultural land. So when an immobile property is purchased, TDS is to be deducted. At present, the term consideration for immobile property is not defined for the purpose of this section. Now, what is consideration? The amount listed in the document. Now, what are the things that are to be included? All this was not clarified by the section. Now, the clarity is made and the clarity is not very clear. In the transaction involving purchase of immovable property, certain other payments like club membership fees. Now these things are becoming very relevant. Now if you purchase a house in a modern society, you need to pay membership fees for every facility. Car parking fees, electricity and water facility fees are made besides the sale consideration and the buyer is contractually bound to make such payments to the seller. Earlier what we thought was that at the price at which we purchased the property, on that price we were supposed to deduct 1%, but now there are some additional payments like club membership fee, then car parking fee, then electricity fee, then X, Y, Z, various fees which the buyer is contractually bound. So if there is a contract where these kind of payments are to be made, then these payments also are clubbed in the consideration for transfer of immovable property and I need to deduct TDS at the rate of 1% on the total amount including all these expenses. Accordingly, it is proposed to amend explanation to 194IA and the term consideration for immovable property shall include all charges of the nature of club membership fee, car parking fee, electricity fee and any other charges of similar nature which are incidental to the transfer of such property. Suppose I am selling a property for 55 lakhs and I am charging 5 lakh rupees for other things, then TDS at the rate of 1% would be deducted not on 55 lakhs but on 60 lakhs. So this is a very troublesome thing. This amendment takes place with effect from 1st September 2019 and here please note it very carefully that there is no explanation that this will not be treated as income received by the assessee. Now if I am taking club membership fee, I am framing a separate cooperative society for the amount received for club membership fee, then how can that be treated as an income of the builder? but this is not properly addressed by the department, so there remains a lacuna in this particular provision 194 IA. So now we have had a discussion of all the changes in TDS related provisions 194A, 10,000 to 40,000, then 194DA, 1% from insurance receipts, 1% to 5%, it has been enhanced. 194I, limit on rent 180 to 240. 194 and TDS on cash withdrawals we have discussed. 194IA, that is transfer consideration for transfer of immovable property, that too we have discussed. So we have discussed all the changes in TDS related provisions that are applicable. Fine. 194M is the last provision in the TDS family. Again, a very interesting provision. Under the existing provisions, an individual or HUF were not liable to deduct TDS under 194C or 194J. TDS under 194C or 194J was applicable subject to limits. One thing. And that too, only when the individual or HUF was liable to tax audit in the preceding previous year. Otherwise, these sections were not applicable. Such payments were for personal use. When these payments were for business use, only then TDS was to be deducted. When they were for personal use, no TDS was to be deducted. Suppose I have given a contract for construction of my house of 1 crore rupees to an architect. Yeah. I was under no obligation to deduct TDS, and the 1 crore rupee amount that I give to the builder went unnoticed without deducting any TDS. The individual or HUF was carrying on business or profession which was not subject to audit under 44AB of the Act. If it was subject to audit under 44AB, then I was supposed to deduct TDS. Thus, substantial payments were made in respect of contractual work or professional services escaping the levy of TDS, thus leaving a loophole for possible tax evasion. Means, payments for personal expenses and payment for business expenses where the person was not subject to audit, where such huge payments were made, they went unnoticed without any audit trail or without any TDS trail. So the government has brought in 194M to keep a check on these transactions as well. To plug in this loophole, section 194M has been inserted, wherein an individual or HUF making payment in respect of contractual work or professional services, that is under 194C and 194J, in excess of INR 50 lakhs in a year are required to deduct TDS. Now the limit is not 30,000 and 1 lakh rupees, the limit is 50 lakh rupees. So if a hefty payment is made, suppose I am hiring a Supreme Court lawyer for fighting a personal case on me in the Supreme Court and I am paying him 2 crore rupees fees, then in that case I am supposed to deduct TDS. Fine. However, in order to reduce the compliance burden, such individuals and HUFs shall deposit TDS using their PAN, because these are not business individuals liable for audit who are supposed to deduct TDS. Fine. So they are not having any TAN, so they can deposit TDS using their PAN and need not obtain their TAN. So there is no need to obtain TAN for them. They can deposit the TDS using PAN. So these are all the six amendments in the TDS related sections. Very important amendments. Fine. 269 SU talks about digital payment. Now, everywhere the government is saying that digital payments are a must, the country is moving towards a digital economy. Now, suppose I feel that I should go digital and stop payments in cash, but then there should be infra available in the country, infra available with the persons from whom I purchase to accept the cards, to accept the UPI. So what the government has done is, it has mandated certain businesses to compulsorily activate certain digital payment infrastructures. Now, what is this? Section 269 SU prescribes the electronic modes for payments acceptance that an individual who is engaged in business has to provide in addition to the other electronic facility or digital mode of payment already available for the customer. So some mechanisms were already available. In addition to it, the government has also insisted on some business houses to also accept payment through these particular digital modes. So to whom it is applicable and what are the modes, that we will be discussing now. Section 269 SU under Income Tax Act is operative for the traders or businessmen whose total sales, turnover or gross receipts from business is more than 50 crore rupees in the just preceding previous year. So if my turnover is exceeding 50 crore rupees in financial year 18-19, then I need to have all these digital modes of payments if it exceeds 50 crore. So this is for large traders. Fine. This section became effective from 1st November 2019. This indicates the relevance of this section in the case when sales, turnover or gross receipts are more than 50 crores for the fiscal year ended on 31st March 2019. Because for the period beginning on 1st November 19, the immediately preceding previous year would be year ending on 31st 19. So if the turnover in financial year 18-19 exceeds 50 crores, then I am supposed to keep this digital payment mechanism. This is not advisory issued by the government. This is a provision, and the non-compliance of this provision would also attract penalty. That also we will be discussing. Required facilities. So what are the infras that you need to keep? First is debit card powered by RuPay. Second is UPI, Unified Payment Interface, BHIM UPI. This you all would be aware of. And the third one is Unified Payments Interface Quick Response Code, UPI QR Code, BHIM UPI QR Code. So debit card and QR code and BHIM UPI. So these are the three mechanisms which 269 SU mandates businesses having turnover exceeding 50 crore rupees to compulsorily keep. Again telling you, this is not an advisory issued by the government. This is a provision which every SSE needs to comply with, and if it is not complied with, no issues. 271 DB, penalty for contravention of 269 SU. If you don't follow, then you need to pay penalty. The penalty under 271 DB of the act will not be applicable to the concerned person to install electronic modes of payment. Just a minute. At his business venture until 31st January 2024, giving him enough time to install the same. Provision is applicable from 1st November. It is very good if you comply with the provision from very 1st November. But November, December and January, 3 months are given to you to equip yourself with these equipments. For 3 months, no penalty would be levied. But then if you don't comply with these provisions in 3 months, then you are never going to do it. Fine. Also, it is to be noted that the concerned person will be liable to pay 5000 rupees per day. This is per day from 1st February 2020 onwards, in case he fails to do the required installation of electronic mode of payments under 271 DB of the Act. So 31st January 2020 is declared as a moratorium till which you are supposed to follow this provision. But if from 1st February you do not adhere to this provision, then daily penalty of 5000 rupees would be applicable to you under 271 DB. Fine. Relief under section 89. This is a very important amendment. Section 89 of the Income Tax Act contains provisions for providing tax relief where salary etc. is paid in arrears or in advance. We all are clear with this relief under 89. So what is the amendment here? The existing provisions of 140A, 143, 243A, 243B, 243C means self-assessment tax and interest under all these heads contain provision relating to computation of tax liability and allowing credit for prepaid taxes and certain admissible reliefs, credits, etc. So my tax liability would be adjusted against any tax I have paid earlier, TDS that has been deducted earlier, and after that the amount which remains as payable, only on that particular amount interest would be chargeable. But one difficulty in this provision was, however, the relief under section 89 is not specifically mentioned in these sections, which is resulting into genuine hardship in case of taxpayers who are eligible for relief. Now suppose I am eligible for relief, then I am not supposed to pay interest on that particular amount, because if my tax liability is zero, then how am I supposed to pay interest? So now this was a loophole in the provision, now which has been taken well care of by the department, and this is in the benefit of the assessee. In view of the above, it is proposed to amend 140A, 143, 243A, 243B and 243C to provide that computation of tax liability shall be made after allowing relief under 89. So now, out of my tax liability, TDS, relief, advance tax, prepaid tax, everything would be deducted, and on the final amount only I would be required to pay interest. Fine. So this is a relief to the SSE. These amendments will take effect retrospectively from 1st April 2007. So now all the cases of salary returns where relief is given, we don't need to worry about it. And we'll accordingly apply in relation to AY 78 and subsequent assessment year. So this is an amendment and relief under 89, which will now be allowed as a deduction when computing the self-assessment tax and interest on it. Amendment in 270 capital A, a very important amendment. When we are going to for assessment, this is a very important amendment when talking about cases which are reopened for assessment under 148. Cases of underreported income. Now the provision earlier stood as, what is underreporting of income? Penalty under 270 capital A is applicable on under-reporting or misreporting of income. On under-reporting, it is applicable at the rate of 50% of tax, and on misreporting, it is applicable at the rate of 200% of tax. This is the provision as it stood earlier. It remains the same. There have been cases where a notice under 148 was issued to the assessee, and the assessee declares the income in it and pays tax and interest thereon. Suppose one of my client had concealed long-term capital gain on sale of some property of 50 lakh rupees, and after 5 years he has been issued a notice under 148. Now he very well knows that he had escaped this particular income. So on receipt of a notice under 148, what he does is he is given an opportunity to file an ITR. He files an ITR, declares that income of 50 lakh rupees and pays appropriate tax and interest thereon. So now this becomes a foolishness. If I have the opportunity to pay tax when the department comes to the notice of it, then why shall I go ahead and pay the tax earlier? If the department does not come to know of it, then there is no need to pay tax. And if they come to know of it, I should go on and immediately declare tax. And interest is the logical, interest is supposed to be paid as I had that money in my hand. So I would have made some money out of it. So I was supposed to pay interest. So this was a loophole. Now, as the AO had not made any addition, he could not impose any penalty under 270A. But see, if AO makes any addition, then there becomes a case of misreporting or underreporting of income. But I am genuinely declaring the income in the notice issued under 148, the return that I am filing consequent to it. So I have not escaped any income. I have not done any misreporting or underreporting of income. So there becomes no question of levying penalty by the AO. So now if no penalty can be charged in these cases, then who is going to come in the front and declare the income? So this becomes a very big loophole. But this loophole has now been repaired. Now, penalty under 270A is applicable when, this is an amendment, a very important amendment when we are going for assessment cases, the income is greater than the maximum amount not chargeable to tax where no return of income has been furnished. It means if you have not furnished your income tax return and your income exceeds the maximum amount not chargeable to tax, the department will deem that you have either misreported or underreported your income. Or, now these bold letters have been added, where return has been furnished for the first time under 148. It means that for the first return that you furnish under 148, if you declare any income, the government or the department can treat it to be under reporting or misreporting of income and can levy penalty on it with WREF. This means with residual effect from 1st April 2017. So this will apply to all the earlier assessment cases as well. So now, if I declare income in the return filed consequent to notice issued under 148, I declare any income, pay interest thereon, then also the government can treat it to be under-reporting or misreporting of income and the AO can levy penalty and initiate penalty proceedings against me. So this is a very important amendment. Now, with this, we conclude all the amendments, all the changes in ITR forms and all the changes that are relevant for filing assessment year 2021's returns. So now you all would be relaxed. You are trying to do it much early. On filing the ITRs, there's no question of being relaxed because one more worry is added. After filing the ITR, e-verification of it becomes very necessary. Aadhaar OTP. If the conventional method of sending physically signed copy to the CPC is followed, the proper ITRV won't be generated. We will just be given a form where only it will be written that I have filed an ITR and I am supposed to submit it to the CPC. Once I submit it to the CPC, it gets processed, then only a proper ITRV acknowledgement will be generated. So in these cases, e-verification of the ITRs become very necessary. Only after the verification process is completed, a detailed ITRV would be available on the portal. So after linking Aadhaar, now the first task with us was to link Aadhaar and PAN. We faced lot many difficulties in it because there were some name issues, some date of birth issue. There were lot many issues. Now one more trouble is added on our part. Also link mobile number with it for quick verification. For e-verification, we need Aadhaar OTP, and Aadhaar OTP is sent to the assessee only when his mobile number is linked to the Aadhaar card. So again, this job becomes a new task for all of us. If we do not do it, this is how the acknowledgement will look. On filing the return, this kind of an acknowledgement will be issued where no income, no tax, no deduction, nothing would be mentioned. I have to sign this particular form, send it to the CPC, and once it is processed by the CPC, proper acknowledgement in ITRV would be generated. So when our client is in a hurry to get return for loan purpose, submitting it to the bank, e-verification is the only option available with us. Now friends, this is all from my end. Thank you very much for a patient hearing. I hope this session would have been meaningful to you. It would surely have added to some value to the precious time you have invested and trusted in all of us. Thank you very much, friends.